Hey guys, welcome to Muscle Memory. My name's Malcolm. A great poet once said, "It's a new year and we are outside. Run your mouth and we are going to pull up because we are outside." Oh, nice glasses. Yeah, we are outside. You got problems, we can solve them because we are outside. That man's name was Anthony J. Francis, my guest today. How are you, sir?
I'm great. Could you read that for me exactly how you just read it again?
It is a new year and we are outside. Run your mouth and we are going to pull up. Yeah, we are outside. You have got problems. We can solve them because we are outside.
Dollar, dollar. Right.
Yes.
Okay, yeah.
How are you, sir?
That was great. You should do a whole YouTube page of you just reading rap lyrics in that voice.
Yeah, spoken word is my true passion outside of professional wrestling, but that's just my personal agenda.
Speaking words and spoken word are not the same thing. You know that, right?
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
Totally, I definitely knew that. Didn't you just didn't teach me so much in one sentence? But you're pretty busy. You do a lot of things. Your weekends seem a little packed. How are you? How's your schedule since now leaving one place and now you're in all the other places? What's your schedule like?
It's great. I love my schedule. I get to make my own schedule. I get to work with who I want to work with. I get to go where I want to go. I got TNA coming up. I got NWA coming up. I got MOW coming up. I got CCW coming up. I got, Second City Wrestling coming up. I got, all the craziest things coming up. It's a lot going. I'm very much looking forward to this run that I've been on. It's been a lot of fun. And my name is Hot in Them Streets.
They are. You're really good at self-promoting yourself. I feel like anywhere you go, I always see you somewhere on my timeline promoting something. You have like 10 different events coming up all at the same time. Do you think you're busier now outside of WWE than you were when you were a part of WWE?
Absolutely. There was a very brief time, maybe a couple months, where we would do house shows and stuff, but for the vast majority, I would literally just fly to whatever city SmackDown was in on Thursday, do SmackDown Friday, and then fly home Saturday. So majority of my time in WWE was a very light schedule, not because I didn't, I famously went on Road Dogg's podcast and asked him. I said, "Road Dogg, how often is it someone asks you to be on more house shows so they can make the same amount of money and work more?" And he was like, "Yeah, that doesn't come around a lot. You definitely did that, right?" So it wasn't because I was trying to work a light schedule. I was just given one, and so now I can actually go hit the road and do all the things I like to do.
A lot of wrestling fans are always curious because they think about like, oh, WWE, you get paid so much money, and then you leave WWE and maybe the money diminishes. Are you making more money now outside of WWE than you were while you're a part of it?
And certain weekends, yeah. I mean, I was making good money in WWE. Not every weekend, but certain weekends, yeah. I mean, with dollar moves merch in front of the people, you know what I'm saying? And on top of that, I'm working at least two, most times three shows a weekend. So it's like three rates, three chances to sell merch. I'm making good money, you know what I'm saying? So it's a good time. And more importantly to me is like I'm getting to do the things I want to do. I'm gonna have a cage match for the first time. I'm gonna, be doing working with my friends. I got a match with, Alex Kane, destined in our future. So like people that I want to work with and I always wanted to work with, I'm getting an opportunity to work with them now. So it's cool.
Yeah, you made a shock debut at MLW. I don't think anyone really saw that coming. Alex Kane was very shocked as well that he joined World Titan Federation. Why did you decide to join them and not like BUMIA instead? Because it seems very polar opposite of what you might stand for as a person to join World Titan Federation.
Yeah, they paid me. They cut the check. Alex never offered a check. He offered me to be a part of his movement, but he never offered a check. I already do enough charity work. I got a gun violence prevention event that I'm doing with Tunnel Vision in Maryland on March 10th. It's a charity basketball game. I do my annual canned food drive in November. I do trunk or treat. I do back to school drives. I do shoe giveaways. I do a lot of charity work. I don't need to do any for Boumaier, okay? WTF paid me, and so I'm going to take that money.
Do you have any interest in going after the MLW World Championship? I know there's a new World Champion crown. Are you interested in going after that title?
I'm interested in all the big money fights. If there's money to be made, I'm interested. Yeah, I could definitely go after the MLW World Championship. Alex Kane was the world champion for how long?
A few months, like a lot of months, actually. He was a
pretty
good title reign.
He had a pretty good title reign, so it can't be that hard to get, you know? So I think that I'm going to definitely have my sights on him. And then after I'm done with him and I've disposed of him, then I can set my sights elsewhere.
Oh my gosh. So those are definitely fighting words. I'm excited to see it. To even, like, I guess, shift gears, another promotion, NWA. They announced that you're going to be at Hard Times. I mean, that's going to be a huge pay-per-view. That's going to be in Alabama. That's going to be cool for you to be out there. Is there anyone in particular that you're looking at the NWA roster? You're like, all right, I want to step in the ring with him, et cetera. Like, who do you want to face?
I only really have one name on my mind. I mean, I know a bunch of people there, you know, like Joe Alonzo. I actually wrestled Joe Alonzo. There's no proof of this because it was on tour. And I was doing this like bar fight thing before I ever signed with WWE. And me and him had a match in a bar, and there was like a bubbles machine. So the floor was like slippery as hell. And we're like slipping all over the place during this match. It finished with me power bombing him through a door that was set up on the bar and on a pool table. And then that was the finish of the match. And none of this was caught on video because the guy recording the video, the water from the bubbles got in the camera and ruined the footage. So it never happened in the real world because nobody could see it. But it definitely did happen. And then I've had more matches with Brian Idol than any other person on earth. I've had more matches against Brian Idol than anybody. I've wrestled Brian Idol in 1, 2, 3, like I think 4 different promotions. So yeah, these are guys that I have my eye on. Obviously EC3 has the gold, and you know, he does look the part. He looks like a champion. Do I think that I could be a better NWA champion? Yeah, I do. Strictly because I'm better. And also on top, like, I'm better on the mic. I mean, I'll have better abs, but that's like it, you know? Who needs abs?
No one.
Why have a six-pack when you can have a keg? I got one really big ab. You know, I don't need 6. I don't need 8. You know, there's a lot of people that I would like to face in NWA. But for now, you know, we'll just see what happens at Hard Times. Looking forward to it. Dothan, Alabama. Next couple weeks are going to be cool.
I feel like you being an NWA is a very different from what, like, most wrestling fans would name picture, like the current NWA, the former NWA. What can fans expect out of you going to this promotion that they might not have seen beforehand?
Well, it's about time NWA got the world's hottest NWA. I'm the guy that everybody's got a problem with till they see me in real life. On the internet, it's all smoke. In real life, it's all nope. And, you know, I bring a different flavor than all these other losers. You know what I'm saying? Like, all these wrestle guys, man, they can wrestle, but they don't make people give a damn. And you can say whatever you want about me, but people care what I do, and people care what I say. And if you don't believe me, go on the internet literally any day of the week.
Oh, man. I'm excited to see that. Again, promotion switch, TNA. I mean, you're just a busy guy, so I feel like I keep bouncing between them. They just announced that your first ever in-ring match for TNA is going to be... Yeah. Hey, no, leave me alone. They announced your first ever... And that's your first ever in-ring match for TNA is going to be this Saturday, apparently, in New Orleans. What can you expect to be in this tag team match? Is you and Dean are taking on Joe Hendry and Rich Swann?
I'm going to be honest with you. I appreciate Dean finally listening to me and understanding how I can help him, what I can bring to the table. Rich Swann still being stubborn, still being hard-headed. I really don't want to have to put hands on that boy, but if I got to, I got to. I really, this isn't about him. It's about Joe Hendry. It's my first opportunity to get my hands on Joe Hendry in a match. It's my first match in TNA. So I got a lot of things to show and look up to and live up to. I am very much looking forward to that. And, you know, Joe Hendry has been a colossal pain in the ass ever since the day that I set foot in TNA. Sticking his nose where it don't belong. And just not minding his damn business. And twice, that's already got him the best choke slam in the business. And I think he may have learned his lesson and he might start taking this a little bit more seriously of what I can do to him and how I can hurt him in a very, very, very real way. But time will tell. That brother is hard-headed too. So it's only a matter of time. Thankfully, Saturday, I get my first chance to put my hands on him, and I'm going to take care of him.
So obviously, like, you're always in the ring or, like, on stage when you're showing these music videos. When you sit back and, like, maybe watch them back, it's like, all right, like, what's your initial reaction then watching once you cooled off from, obviously, chokeslamming the guy a couple times?
I never watch it again. It's not worth my time. It's not worth the views. It's not worth the access of my eyes. That man, we are comparing Jay-Z to Weird Al Yankovic. That brother is a parody of a musical artist. And I'm not saying he's not talented, but I'm actually talented. I'm actually a musician. I'm not doing my best to make people laugh on parodies of other people's songs. I make my own songs. And I've made at more than one entrance song. So, you know, I have the ability to make more than one song that's mine. He should try it.
Oh my gosh. What's been your experience so far being a part of TNA? Because I feel like it was a big shock to everyone to see you like jump over to Hard to Kill. What's been your experience in this TNA locker room so far?
I love TNA, man. I love working with the people there. I enjoy all the people there that actually go out of their way to, you know, make me feel welcome. Let me know that I feel welcome, validate the fact that I'm there and that I'm working and that I'm part of the crew. You know, I know what I can bring to TNA and every wrestling promotion. And finally, I have somewhere that knows what I can bring too. And they appreciate what I can bring. They appreciate the eyes I put on the product from being on the Pat McAfee show or many of the other things that I do. Like, they appreciate the fact that I can bring somebody like a DJ Who Kid. We're going to talk some, you know, some things came up, but Bun B was supposed to be in New Orleans this weekend. Like, hip-hop legends are going out of their way to try to be a part of TNA because I'm asking them to. They recognize what I can bring to the table. I already talked to West Side Gunn about fourth rope culture, you know what I'm saying, and TNA. So, like, there's a lot that I can bring to the table from the sports world, from the hip-hop world, and exposure that I can bring. Whatever I say, people care about. Like, I didn't do anything to deserve it. You know, people just care what I have to say. So I say shit.
It clearly works too. I heard that you were trying to work with Cheez-Its to get like a sponsorship with TNA. Is that still in the works right now?
Yeah, we still are talking to them. It's getting to the point right now where, like, I'll know more. Obviously, there's been a change at the top in TNA. So I'll know more once I get the lay of the land in New Orleans this weekend. But yeah, that would still be cool. That's something, it's not just Cheez-Its. I have other sponsors that I'm trying to, you know, get involved too. I bring a lot to the table, man, and I can. And so I actively go out of my way to try to. I believe that the tide raises all boats. So I want to be part of the successful rebrand of TNA. And, you know, there's been some people that don't think that. Now, I love Scott, and Scott himself told me to keep working, keep doing what I'm doing, that I'm doing a great job. And some people want to bury TNA because Scott is no longer there. I'm not one of those people. Scott wouldn't want that. So it's like, I believe that we keep going and we keep showing what Scott would want us to do. Scott would want us to put on the best show possible. So I'm excited for the opportunity because, you know, Tommy Dreamer's the reason I'm in TNA, but Scott was the final, all right, yeah, let's give him a chance. And so after I got my chance, I made the most of it, and that's why I'm still here today. So, like, I'm very appreciative of everything he's done. But TNA is not dead. And TNA just got brought back to life, and we're going to keep living.
Were you shocked to see that Scott is, like, no longer with TNA? Because I know a lot of wrestling fans and maybe even some talent were pretty shocked to hear about his release.
Yeah, everybody was shocked, you know. But, you know, I've talked to him since. He seems to be in a good place. And he knows that it's not – it's just like when I got released. Like I knew it wasn't the end of the road. And look at it 4 months later, 5 months later now. Look at me now. I'm hotter than I ever was in WWE. Right? So it's like, you know, you never know. One door closes, another one opens. You never know what can come around, you know? So it's like, I know he's in good spirits. And, but yeah, I think everybody was shocked. The entire world was.
It definitely seemed like it. You mentioned WWE. Right now, your former Hit Row partners, Shante the Adonis and B-Fab, doing other stuff right now on SmackDown. B-Fab's mm-hmm. with Lashley and his faction. Shante apparently is going to be tag teaming with Cedric Alexander. Have you watched like what they're doing currently on WWE, and what's your thoughts on them?
Yeah, to be honest with you, as you can imagine, I don't go out of my way to watch WWE. But obviously, I watch all of their stuff because I care about them a lot. I love them a lot. I love B-Fab was in the Battle Royal. I loved her new gear. I love her new look. I love what she's doing. I love that she's actually getting an opportunity. Tahuti is in this new tag team with Cedric. They're doing like a whole Bad Boys thing where he's like Wolf Smith's character and Cedric is like Martin Lawrence's character. It's very entertaining. You know, Ashante has been very entertaining for a long time. Once again, I'm glad he's getting his opportunities. I was seated for Jey Uso versus Gunther for the Intercontinental title. Jey is a very good friend, and then so is Jimmy. So when Jimmy came out, like, it was one of those things that, like, and I texted Jimmy and Jey the day of on Monday. And I just told Jey, I was like, you're going to kill it, Uso, do your thing. He was like, yeah. And then he said some other shit too. And I texted Jimmy, and I was like, yo. I told him, I said, no matter what the script says, man, don't get involved. Let Jey get it done. You know what I'm saying? And he was like, nah, Jey, you know, in classic protect the business, brother. He was like, he's Jey's going over. And I was like, oh, word? I was like, hype. I actually said, man, don't get me too hype for no reason. You know, obviously, you know, I waited. I didn't say anything because, A, I figured he was full of shit. And, B, like, that's just not my place, you know. And then as soon as the night was over, he texted me back. He was like, Mania. I'm like, yeah, Mania. You know what I'm saying?
So, you think they saw at WrestleMania. Who do you think wins between Jimmy and Jey?
That's a good question. I think that the story would dictate that Jey would win, obviously.
Yeah.
But Solo's still in the picture.
Yes.
Yeah. Rock is in the picture. Yeah. Roman's in the picture. Heyman's in the picture. Mm-hmm. And it's just Jey Uso, you know? So it's like, I mean, the story would dictate that Jey would win, but either way, I genuinely think they're going to steal the show. I would not want to go after Jimmy and Jay in a solo match at WrestleMania. I would literally not want to follow that. I don't give a shit who you are. Because they're going to go out with the intent to steal the show. And, you know, I talked to Jimmy about it, and I was like, yo, man, this is what you dreamed about since you was a kid. You know what I'm saying? Like, really think about that. Like, you grew up watching wrestling with your brother. Your dad is a wrestler. Like, and as kids, you're like, man, that's going to be us one day. We're going to face at WrestleMania. And, like, now you are.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
I'm huge.
So it's like, man, it's like amazing to hear. Like, it's amazing, bro. So it's like, I'm very happy for them. And obviously, I'm still very happy for B-Fab and Ashante. And I hope that they get an opportunity to do something at WrestleMania as well.
Of course. You mentioned Rock. To ask you almost like a football-related question, the UFL launches very soon. What do you think the success rate of that brand will be? Because we've seen a lot of launches over the years. And as a guy that played in the NFL, what's your thoughts on the UFL becoming like the new spring league?
As long as, like, the problem with the spring leagues is that they don't have their finances in order. They keep hemorrhaging money, and then they have to either sell or close shop. If their finances are in order, which I feel like they should be because they have so many TV deals, they're on, like, six networks or some shit. Like,
yeah.
So, like, if the finances are in order, the spring football league will last forever. Americans love football, right? And then you throw in the fact of, like, there's going to be a lot of guys who didn't get opportunities in the NFL that are still great football players, you know, that then shine in these leagues, and then NFL teams will pick them up, and that'll be like a story, right? So it's like, it's cool because look at it like this, like, there's only, pull your calculator out.
Don't mind if I do. Yes.
What's 32 times 63?
That is 2016.
So there's 2016 spots in the NFL, including the practice squad. Yep. So 2,000 spots. Now, do me another favor. Go to high school. Put in high school football seniors annually.
Seniors annually. Okay. Gotcha.
What's that number?
Not seeing a number yet. Let's take a guesstimation because I can't find it.
Look up high school senior football players.
High school senior football players.
Number. Number
per year. I'm a communication major, not a computer guy. Let's assume it's a big number because I still don't know it.
That's crazy. You're bad at this. All right. So there's millions of high school football players. There's like, including D1, D1, AA, D2, D3. I think there's like 2,000 or something teams, yeah. Right? There's only 2,000 spots in the NFL, okay? Some of the best players ever, like guys I played with in college that would have definitely played in the NFL, but circumstance, opportunity stopped them from getting there. Just like you got guys like Moose could absolutely be in WWE, but circumstances and opportunity fucked that up, right? So, like, he's not there. But it's not that he's not good enough. Same concept in football. Like, there's only 2,000 spots in the NFL. Mm-hmm. So you're going to get a lot of guys with a lot of talent in the UFL. Mm-hmm. I got friends that I played with in the NFL that got an invite to join the UFL, and they're going to play. You know what I'm saying? So it's like, and they're great players. My boy Ty Smith is a great player. We played together in Seattle and in DC. He's a great player. He played well for the Titans and the Vikings. He's made game-winning interceptions. He's a defensive back. He's a great player. He's going to get opportunity to show how good he is in this league and then hopefully get back in the NFL. So that's, I think the best thing is the fact that guys that deserve to be in the NFL are going to get an opportunity to go back.
Amazing. There was a story that you and Richard Sherman had had a like a bet of who could do the most RKOs during a match or during a football game. What was that story? I just want to know the whole thing.
So it wasn't, I wasn't really a bet, but it was like, so me and Sherm were obviously on the Seahawks together. And obviously I was a huge wrestling fan. And he's not the biggest wrestling fan, but he like knows wrestling. He like knows who Randy Orton is, obviously.
Yeah.
So like I was just doing this thing where I would like act like I was gonna RKO people, but I would just do the catch. I wouldn't like go all the way down because I'm not a psychopath, right? But I would just, you would just try to, like how you would try to dunk on somebody at a doorway. You know what I'm saying? It was just a game like that, where it was like, so like I was trying to catch people, and there were certain people I knew not to bother with these kind of shenanigans, like Marshawn Lynch. And then there were people like Sherm that I knew would have fun with it. So I would do, you know what I'm saying? I would do it with Sherm. And then Sherm got like really into it and was doing it to a lot of people and ended up doing it in the Pro Bowl, actually. So like, you know, obviously I never went to a Pro Bowl, but it was like cool because Sherm is like a cool dude to be around. Like he has this persona on TV, and yes, he is kind of like that in person, but like he's genuinely a fun guy to be around. So, and I'll give you another Richard Sherman story. True story. I'm in Vegas for my boy's bachelor party. And I'm still in the NFL. We having a good time. So we get the table. I'm like, the table comes with like five bottles, right? So I'm like, we got the girls, you know what I'm saying? It's Vegas. We having a time, you know what I'm saying? Bottles come out, you know, two bottles come out with the sprinklers. The sparklers. We're like, we lit. Everybody posted that shit. You know, two more bottles come out probably like an hour later. And while the bottles are coming out, Sherm is just walking in. And we're not teammates anymore because I want to say this was like 2016, 2017. But we're not teammates anymore, but obviously we know each other still. So he walks in and his table just happens to be next to mine, like just by chance. So I see him, I was like, I go see him, I say, what's up? We dap up, we talking, blah, blah, blah. He saw my bottles coming in. He was like, yo, I'm about to get some bottles. You want to drink some? Feel free. And me, you know, I'm like, yeah, I got you. I'm going to tell you, you know what I'm saying? But in my mind, I'm like, I'm my own bottles. I don't need your motherfucking bottles, dog. Like, so then, like, boom, maybe 15 minutes later, his bottles come out. And I'm getting, like, Patron, Henny, Goose. Like,
Deer Park.
These are not Deer Park. Well, it was not Deer Park, it was Fiji.
Oh, okay.
You know, these are quality beverages.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. This man come out with the big jumbo Ace of Spades on that's like 80 grand. And it's being carried by a girl on a dude's shoulders, and another girl got a big sign that says, welcome Richard Sherman. And then like she's on another dude's shoulders, and there's like a 10 girls behind them with sparklers and other bottles. And it's like, and I'm just sitting there like, I'm like looking at all this. And mind you, I found out later he had like a credit, I think, with the hotel or something. Yeah. So he wasn't actually paying for these bottles. It was just part of his like deal of staying there or whatever. So like, but that don't matter. Like these bottles still cost a lot of money. Right. So I got one bottle left and I just see all that shit. And I pulled my waitress over and said, hey, when you bring that bottle out, don't put no sparklers on that shit. You know what I'm saying? I don't need no attention. Just bring the bottle out. Because you can't have a line of women with sparklers and bottles and the biggest Ace of Spades bottle ever and a whole train of people carrying bottles and shit and then come out with one bottle with a sparkler. Like, you can't. Nah, we can't do that. I would just bring that bottle. You know what I'm saying? We're gonna drink it still, but you don't bring the sparkler with it, please. I don't need that.
Oh my gosh. Which NFL player, in your opinion, is the biggest wrestling fan besides yourself?
I think Kittle's a really big wrestling fan. Obviously, he's a really big wrestling fan. I mean, there's a lot of football players that like wrestling. But like active NFL players right now, yeah, I would say George Kittle. I don't even think it's close. He actually pays attention to the product and knows what's going on. And he has relationships with a lot of people in WWE. Like, a lot of times, like NFL, like when I was there in SmackDown, like NFL players would come to like backstage or like to the show, and like I played with them or like I knew them. So like I would go say what's up to them, talk to them, and they might be there at the show, but they don't know anybody there other than like Roman Reigns or, you know, top guys, Randy Orton's, Sheamus, you know, guys that have been there forever. So, but like Kittle is like in on it. Like he has relationships with a lot of different people in the locker room. So I would definitely say Kittle.
Amazing, man. As we start to wrap this up, you do so much stuff. You're in TNA, you're MLW, NWA. I saw a tweet recently. You said you've been on ESPN four times, Fox two times, NBC two times, ABC two times, SiriusXM six times, TMZ one time. Is there any other three letters, four letters that you're looking to go to in the year 2024 or years to come?
Yeah, AAA, me and Conan are working on that. That'll be a good one. Definitely, I've been on CBS before. I'm sure I'll do it again. I'm watching CBS right now, actually. Did you know that they do Wheel of Fortune at night?
I did not know it was at night.
Yeah, they do like on Wednesdays at 8 p.m., they do like a primetime Wheel of Fortune, and the prizes are huge because it's nighttime. But I grew up, I love the Wheel of Fortune. That's like my favorite game show when I was a kid. I loved Bob Barker, and then obviously I loved Drew Carey. I loved Drew Carey when he did Whose Line Is It Anyway with Wayne Brady and Norm MacDonald. So those were good times. But, I was CBS, AAA for sure. I'm just naming ones I haven't done yet. There's a lot, honestly. I'm really much looking forward to just still going out there and fighting my friends. I'm looking forward to that match, the build to the match and the match versus Alex Kane. He needs something right now to elevate him after losing his championship. If he'd have been good enough to keep that championship a little bit longer, then we'd be fighting for his championship and I'd be the new MLW champion. But, that's another story for another day. I'm very much looking forward to getting around the world for sure.
AJ, you've done so much and I'm excited to see what else you're going to do. Where can I find you on social media? They're not already following you.
All social media at AJ Francis 410. That's every social media you can think of is AJ Francis 410. Follow me on all social media, so you're smart. But if you don't follow me on social media, it's nothing against you, but you need to do better. So follow me on all social media at AJ Francis 410. Let's work to get together to get Malcolm some more golf shirts. I do like this one that you have on right now.
Thank you.
The zipper is across, which is a nice touch, I believe.
No, this is actually just a separate chain.
Major letdown.
I don't really think so. I just think it's a nice chain. This is lovely.
It's a nice chain for a
thank you.
Junior high school youth pastor for sure.
My girlfriend got me this. I like it. I like it very much, actually.
We gotta boss you up a little bit. Just a little bit. You know what I'm saying?
Hey, if you're willing to provide, I'm willing to wear. So thank you very much for that. What I heard is he's going to buy me free chains, and that's on the internet, so it has to live forever. AJ Francis, thank you so much, and we're going to end there before you can say no. My name is Malcolm. This is Muscle Memory, and we're out.
Dollar, dollar, I'm a Pioneer City baby. Nana tried to save me, but I go where they pay me. Yeah, the flow is wavy, deeper than the Navy. And the bass kicking like a D-boy in the 80s. Yeah, my whole